All right. Tonight, for a couple minutes, a few minutes, however long it takes me to, I hate reading. Really, I love reading. I hate reading in church, but there was so much here that I really could not get it all down. And it only take me a couple minutes to read it, probably. Yesterday, what's today's date? I mean, what is today's date? 12th. When is St. Patrick's Day?
Friday.
Coming up, or it was?
Coming up.
Coming up. Okay. St. Patrick's Day is, I know they were going to have the parade in Syracuse, and Utica, it was so cold in Utica they didn't have it yesterday. I don't know about Syracuse. They did? They did, okay. This particular article is entitled, St. Patrick Was a Baptist. Now, I know you tell most people that, or a lot of people that, they laugh at you and you're nuts. I will say this about the guy. I'll read a little bit about it. But when he actually lived around the 3rd century, when he actually lived, there was no Catholic Church as we know it. And for the Catholics to claim him to be a Catholic is really disingenuous. Now, let me read this to you. Excuse me. Our Catholic friends won't like this revelation, but facts are facts. Patrick, whose original name was Sukkot, was born in Scotland about 375 AD and lived about 85 years, dying in 460. As a teen, he was captured by marauding raiders and taken to Ireland, where he was sold to a Druid chieftain and held in slavery for 6 years. Patrick said that he was hungry and naked during that time. He eventually walked 200 miles to the Irish coast to escape and to find his way back to Scotland. The writer of this article says, it is my desire to dispel the myths, delusions, and superstitions and lies that are circulating about Patrick. Of course, he did not drive the snakes out of Ireland. Anybody ever hear that one? There are no snakes in Ireland because he played a pipe and they all followed him, went to the sea. Anybody? No? Okay. He did not drive snakes out of Ireland, but his preaching of Christ drove out the pagan Druids and removed human sacrifice. Also, his assistants in his monastery copied and preserved the Bible and standard texts for us to use today. All this while the Roman Empire was crumbling and the Dark Ages were falling upon Europe, and the Roman Church gained more and more power and riches. Patrick was reared in a Christian home, and his father was a deacon in an evangelical or a Baptistic-type church. Also, his grandfather pastored in these ancient churches of Britain, which had never come under the Roman yoke. As historians wrote more than 100 years ago, the truth which saved him when a youthful slave in pagan Ireland was taught him in the godly home of his father. Under that Christian influence, Patrick felt called to go back to Ireland as a missionary to convert those pagan Druids who had enslaved him. He became one of the most effective missionaries of all time. Some think only second to the Apostle Paul. He refused to take gifts from kings and preached to everyone about the grace of God. Patrick wrote, and you can find online, if you go online, you can find a lot of his writings, things that have been preserved. Patrick wrote that he baptized thousands of people, ordained men to the ministry, counseled and won wealthy women and sons of kings, and trained them for Christian service. He refused to be paid for baptizing people, ordaining preachers, and even paid for the gifts he gave the kings. He was legally without protection since he refused the patronage of kings and was beaten, robbed, and put in chains. He says that he was also held captive for 60 days, but gives no details. It is only natural that the young but growing Roman Church would claim him, but it was and is a bogus claim. One historian wrote, Rome's most audacious theft was when she seized bodily the Apostle Peter and made him the head and founder of her system. Can I just, I'll just say, I'm digressing, but Ben called me and asked some questions about Peter the other day. It does not appear that Peter was ever in Rome. He was in Babylon. Ben said, well, that's a code name for Rome. Well, I don't think so. I believe he was in that place, Babylon. That's where he was. But next to that brazen act stands her effrontery when she annexed the great missionary preacher of Ireland and enrolled him among her saints. Baptists should appreciate the fact that Catholics paid homage to him, even built churches in his honor. However, it is time to realize that Patric was only a very simple, even untrained Baptist preacher. He was not interested in power or position or possessions, but in preaching the simple gospel of Christ. From my study of him, he would be embarrassed and chagrined that a day in his honor is often turned into a drunken orgy, as in many cities it is. The early non-Catholic churches were not called Baptist, but most preached, practiced, and professed what modern Baptists do. If Patric had been a Roman Catholic, then somewhere there would be support for that, but there is none. Patric wrote confessions, epistles to the Irish, and epistles to some man's name I cannot read, and neither did he refer to Rome. The breastplate, a hymn, is also attributed to him. Not one of his early biographers mentioned any Roman connection. Moreover, there is no support for the claim that Pope Celestine sent him to the Irish people. Furthermore, during his life, the Roman Church was only in its embryonic form. The Bishop of Rome was not considered the authoritarian. He became much later. In fact, church authority was split in five directions. The Patriarch at Constantinople, Antioch, Jerusalem, and Alexandria all claimed to have as much authority as the Roman bishop. A professor, a prominent scholar, declared that before a synod in AD 1112, the rule of each Irish church was independent, autonomous, and there were no dioceses in existence. Neander's History of the Christian Church says that the facts prove the origin of the church was independent of Rome. It must be traced solely to the people of Britain. Again, no indication of his connection with the Roman Church is to be found in his confessions. Rather, everything seems to favor the supposition that he was an ordained bishop in Britain itself. One who, O'Driscoll, who incidentally was an Irish Catholic, in his work entitled Views of Ireland, reveals the Christian church of that country, as founded by St. Patric and his predecessors, existed for many ages, free and unshackled from Rome. For 700 years, the church maintained its independence. It had no connection with England and differed on points of importance with Rome. And that's from an Irish Catholic. Another Irish scholar wrote, Leo II was Bishop of Rome from 440 to 461, and upwards of 140 of his letters to correspondents in all parts of Christendom still remain, and yet he never mentions Patric or his work or in any way intimates that he knew of the great work being done there. So until 461, the Roman Church had never tried to make Patric as one of their major saints. Furthermore, the Venerable Bede, father of English history, did not refer to Patric in his ecclesiastical history of the English people. That fact is shattering to Patrick's Roman connection. Moreover, there are many other proofs that Patric was Baptistic in his thought and not a Catholic. He only baptized born-again believers, never infants. He wrote about a convert named Enda who was saved the night after his son Cormac was born. He baptized Enda, but not his infant son. All in all, his letters and his books, Patric never mentions baptizing infants. He wrote of baptized captives, baptized handmaidens of Christ, baptized believers, and he wrote, perhaps since I have baptized so many thousands men, but never infants. An additional proof of his of Patric being baptistic was, his, was he only baptized by immersion. Various church historians record an incident where 12,000 people were converted and baptized. Profiting by the presence of so vast a multitude, the Apostle Patric entered into the midst of them. His soul inflamed with the love of God and with a celestial courage preached the truth of Christianity. And so powerful were the effects of his burning words that the seven princes and over 12,000 more were converted on that day and were soon baptized in a spring called Tobar. Thomas More, in his History of Ireland, says, the convert saw in the baptismal fount where he was immersed the sacred well at which his fathers worshiped. Archbishop Usher admits, Patric baptized his converts in Dublin, including the king's son, in a well near St. Patrick's Church, which in after ages became an object of devotion. Famous church historian William Cathcart stated, there is absolutely no evidence that any baptism but that of immersion of adult believers existed among the ancient Britons in the first half of the 5th century, nor for a long time afterwards. He also wrote, there are strong reasons for believing Patric was a Baptist missionary, and it is certain that his baptism was immersion. No, Patric was a Baptist preacher, not a Roman Catholic priest. Patric knew nothing of confession or forgiveness by a priest. He forbade worship of images. He never told his converts to pray to Mary or any other saint. He never mentions purgatory, holy days, rosary, or last rites. Moreover, Patric never mentioned any pope or cardinal or gives credulity to any creed, catechism, or confession, nor to the Eucharist, relics, or dogma of the Roman Church. Patric was not Irish, nor was he Catholic. He preached, practiced, professed, and promoted Baptist distinctives, and to decline or to declare otherwise is a bunch of Irish blarney, whatever that may be. But anyway, so you can go home. You can find online a lot of things about Patric and about what he believed. As I said, you can go online, and if you type it in, you can find a lot. There are a lot of things about him, mainly that he did. The word Baptist, for example, we're not going to talk about Baptist tonight. I saw a good sermon on that. I might use it one time, but what do Baptists believe? What do they believe? I'm just asking. You know, we say we're Baptistic and what we believe. What do Baptists believe? Salvation through faith. That's right. What else do Baptists believe? What else do they believe? Death, resurrection of Christ. Yeah, that's right. They believe that. What else do they believe? Yeah, okay. All right, let's stop right there, okay? We're going to stop right there. And we're just going to say that Baptists believe the Bible, okay? Because we'll go down from Genesis to Revelation on that. All right, but that, okay, so, all right, we know they believe the Bible. But what else do they believe? What else do Baptists believe? Eternal security. That's correct. They believe in eternal security. And that's important because there are so many groups that do not believe in eternal security. That's right. They believe that. I heard a preacher say, Curtis Hudson say this. There are five things that are essential. Really, the Bible is the Word of God, the virgin birth, the substitutionary atonement, the resurrection, and the second coming. Yeah, those five things are essential in what we believe. But he said this, he almost believed this, that he believed, while he would not be dogmatic about it, but that eternal security was pretty essential. We talked about that in Sunday school again, that if you don't believe that, then you must believe at least to some degree in some kind of a work salvation. What else do Baptists believe? What else do we believe? What do we believe? Oh, thank you. That's correct. We believe in baptism by immersion. Anybody know why we believe that? Death, burial, and resurrection. All right, it's a picture of our death with Christ and our resurrection to newness of life. Being buried with him You bury people, you put them, you throw dirt on them and you bury them. That's why we believe in baptism. One of the reasons, baptism by immersion. The word baptizo means to make fully wet, to dip, to submerge. So that's why we do that. Multitudes of churches believe in they believe in some form where they sprinkle people. I know there are some who pour people. They pour water on you. They say, well, it's like the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, so they pour water on top of you, and they, baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I've seen them baptize. And one of the things that was noted about Patric is that he never baptized infants. We do not baptize infants. Why do we not baptize infants? Does anybody know that? Why don't we baptize infants? Huh? That's correct. The Bible says in Acts chapter 2, and it's meant, then they that gladly received his word were baptized. See, you got to receive the word before you can be baptized. I'll ask you another question. Why do people baptize babies? Anybody know the answer to that? Why do people baptize babies? Wait a minute. First of all, Sarah, go ahead. All right, somebody else said something. Yes.
To remove
original sin. Yeah. I will say this, not Catholics aren't the only one that baptize infants. I know lots of groups that do. But baptizing an infant is going to get them to heaven. There was a belief with in Catholic Church, that if a baby died unbaptized, it would go to limbo. Now, I'm serious when I say this. I know what purgatory is. What is limbo besides a dance? What is limbo? Where is limbo? Well, anyway, that's where they believe babies go that died that were not baptized. And I've had people call me not connected with this church, want to have their babies baptized. And I would always ask them, well, why do you want to do that? We baptize by immersion. We believe in eternal security. That's right. We believe that the Bible is true, and that we believe the fundamentals of the faith. What else do Baptists believe? Anybody else got any idea what Baptists believe? One is this. Baptists believe in soul liberty. So what do you mean by soul liberty, preacher? Well, it was Augustine who said this, and I'm not a big fan of Augustine. Augustine said this about churches, that in a church there ought to be unity on the essentials. All right? You and I would agree we believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. We believe in the second coming, the virgin birth. We are unified on that. In the non-essentials, there should be liberty. And that unless the Bible expressly says something is wrong, then we should have the liberty not to cause a brother to stumble, but that we should have soul liberty. We should have soul liberty. I asked Carol tonight, I said, Carol, do you think they would crucify me if I did not wear a tie tonight? She said, well, if they really knew you, they would. But anyway, it's like, we have soul liberty. Some of you have ties on tonight. Some of you don't. Does that mean that those who don't are heathens? Well, yes, thank you. It doesn't mean that. It just simply means that they have the liberty not to wear a tie. And there are a lot of soul liberty issues. Augustine said on the essentials, unity, on the non-essentials, liberty, but in everything, charity. That we ought to be charitable to our brother, and if we don't agree with him. And we ought to be careful, and we really should be careful, about our soul liberty, that we do not use it as a stumbling block, and that things that we do don't cause all others to stumble. For example, I don't know where Carol got them. I really don't know where she got them. Well, we save bottles. And we take them to the guy down the street, and we get our nickel for them. I don't know where she got beer bottles from. Maybe she's, you know, on the side. I don't know. Oh, walking down the road. Okay, she's walking down. But anyway, I won't take them. I won't take them to get my nickel back. She puts them in the bag. I'm not going to take them back. Because if the guy down the street says, well, Jenkins is up there, he's bringing beer bottles down here. And now he doesn't know that I don't drink. And you know, if you wanted to show you some verses, I mean, we could do that. But I'm not going to do that. And you know, so what do I do? Well, if I you know, throw them in the garbage, well, the garbage man might see them. And then now he's thinking. He said, well, you know, Jenkins is doing that. And so I don't want to do anything that would cause somebody to stumble. But we have soul liberty. We do have soul liberty. At our church, we... And here's another thing about Baptist churches. By and large, Baptist churches are autonomous. Brother Carpenter has a church in Rome. Brother, what's the brother there? And there are two brothers in Utica. One's Jody Martin, and the other is Paul Bannister. Okay, while I know them, and while I know lots of Baptist preachers, know Brother Legault over there in Martville, and Brother O'Neill over in Mexico, and Brother Dunbar down in Auburn. I know lots of preachers and lots of churches, but as a Baptist church, we are autonomous. They don't tell us what to do, and I don't tell them what to do. They probably, Brother Dunbar, love Brother Dunbar. He's a great guy. He really is a good guy. I enjoy being around him, enjoy fellowshipping with him, enjoy his company. If a missionary calls Brother Dunbar up, he's going to say to them, you have got to come to Auburn and we have got to have lunch together and we'll sit down and talk and then I'll decide whether or not you can come to our church. Now, a missionary calls me, he says to me, look, I'm on deputation and I'd like to come to your church. Now, I ask two questions. I ask the same two questions every time. I ask three questions. How did you find me? You know, the FBI's looking at me. No, I just said, how did you find me? And there evidently is a list of churches out there, and we're on it. And then I ask them this question. Are you a King James guy? Got to be yes. And then I ask them the second question. Are you a Calvinist? Are you a Calvinist? And if they hesitate, I mean, even for a split second, now I'm a little leery. I mean, if you say to me, you a Calvinist? No. Are you a Calvinist? No. Are you? No, I'm not. Now, I ask them that question, and that's how I determine whether or not a missionary will come to our church. Brother Dunbar doesn't do that. But this isn't Brother Dunbar's church. I know one of our preacher brethren told me one time, you know how we have communion once a month? First Sunday of the month. So where did you get that? I just pulled it out of thin air. I just said, well, let's do it on the first Sunday of the month. Why not? Now, you say, is there anything in the Bible about that? No, there isn't anything in the Bible about the first Sunday of the month. All that's in the Bible is as often as you do this. Doesn't say how much is often, doesn't say much is seldom. But I know this, that some of them only have communion once every 3 months. Some of them have communion once a year. Now, and this is the truth. I found this hard to believe, but it's not that I doubt my brother on this one, my Christian brother. He just said to me, I can't tell you the last time we had the Lord's table. Now, we're not connected together. Baptist churches are autonomous. That's what we are. I realize that there's the American Baptists, which are Northern Baptist churches. They're pretty liberal. They're really liberal. And they are associated together. I know there are the Southern Baptists, and in the Southern Baptist Convention, some of their preachers will tell you, well, we're autonomous. Others will tell you, no, we're part of the convention. And if your church is part of the convention, if if you said, well, we're tired of the Southern Baptists, we're going to pull out, you're probably going to have a legal fight on your hand over the church who actually has the church. People say, you know, I've had people say, do you own the church? Yeah, I own it. No, do you own the church? No, nobody owns this church. You say, well, who owns the church? Nobody does. We're just incorporated. We're an incorporated entity under the government. I sometimes wonder about that, but we are incorporated. We are an autonomous church. Nobody comes and tells me what we ought to do. You ought to have the Lord's table. I know that some churches have the Lord's table. I've been in Baptist churches that have the Lord's table every single Sunday. In my opinion, on that thing, it becomes like, well, it's just what we do. And it kind of loses its significance. And so Baptist churches believe the Bible. Baptist churches believe in eternal security. Baptist churches practice mission. Baptist churches believe in soul liberty. That's what we believe. We believe that if the Bible does not actually say that something's wrong, because we've discussed this before about eating meat or not eating meat. Some people can eat meat. Some people can't eat meat. Paul said, I can eat meat. That's been offered to idols. But he said, I will not eat meat if it's going to cause my brother to stumble. And he said, as long as the world is, he says, I won't eat that meat offered to idols. Now, if you're of the opinion, you can. Listen, you can take that to the extreme. I know guys say it's a sin to wear sunglasses. How many in here wear sunglasses? Anybody in here wear sunglasses? Okay. You're a bunch of heathen. Now, in some churches, I've heard them say it's a sin to wear sunglasses. I've heard some Baptist guys say this, that little children, and I'm not talking about 2 and 3 year olds. I'm talking about 4, 5, 6 years old. I've heard them say little children cannot be saved. And they discourage little children about being saved. Listen, I believe little kids can be saved. Amen. I believe that from the bottom of my heart. If they can understand it, if they can understand it. My teacher, Sumner Wendt, always said this. He said, when I could turn around and say to my daughter in the back seat, you know what a sin is, and tell me what a sin is, and understand what a sin is, then that child was old enough to be saved. And so we believe that we are autonomous. We believe in soul liberty. We believe that person can know for sure that they are saved. That's what Baptists believe. You say, well, how is that different from Methodist? Now, that you ought to be able to know the answer to that without me even telling you. Baptists sprinkle babies. The church I was saved in, Brother Don was a great guy. He was a great guy. He was one of the best soul winner guys I ever knew in my life. He took a church of 54 people and built it over 900 people. And he did it by a lot of work. I believe he died when he was 62 of a heart attack. But he died he was at a conference prayer meeting. They were going to have revival, and he just finished praying, and he fell over dead. Carol and I have talked about this. The first Sunday of the month in the Methodist Church was the Sunday they took in new members. Okay, fine. It was also the Sunday that they would baptize you if you wanted to get baptized, if you wanted to get sprinkled. Now, Brother Don's a great guy. He would sprinkle you. He'd mercy. He'd pour you. He didn't care what it was. You know, he didn't care. I never could pin the guy down. But Methodists believe in sprinkling. That's not a good picture of being buried with Christ, which baptism is a picture of our burial, our death with Christ, and our resurrection to the newness of life. Sprinkling is not that. But the first Sunday of the month was also the Sunday of baby dedication, where they would dedicate babies. Now, I'm not against baby dedication. I think, good night, if you got a baby and you want to bring that baby down and say, I want to dedicate, and really, it is not so much a dedication of the baby as it is a dedication of the parents saying, we're going to raise that baby the right way. Because how can a little baby that doesn't even know its right hand from its left, as it says in Jonah, he can't tell his right hand from his left, how is that baby going to assent to the fact that I'm going to go to church the rest of my life? So really it is parents who come forward, bring their baby, and say, we want to dedicate our baby to the Lord, that we want to raise the baby the right way. I'm all for that. I think that's a good idea. That is a good idea. It puts you on record with the church and on record before God. Now, let me say quickly, we're not going to get to Psalm 37 tonight. But let me say this quickly. Dave brought out a really good point on Wednesday night about vows, about making vows and then not living up to them, not fulfilling your vow. If a person's going to have a baby, and then they want to dedicate that baby to the Lord and bring that child forward in church, they're making a vow before the people in that church and before God that they're going to raise that baby the right way. Now, you better not do that unless you plan on doing that. God holds you to that. Now, but Brother Don, without fail, would take that baby from the parents and hold that baby and dip his hand into some water, and then he would place it on top of that baby's head and say, I dedicate thee in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, you don't have to be much of a rocket scientist to figure out that what he was doing, he got that from somewhere. And that's exactly what the Catholics do, except they put the word baptize in there. And Brother Don, Mrs. Jenkins and Carol, Mrs. Jenkins was my mother, but Carol and I were talking that one Sunday, Brother Don actually picked the baby up and put his hand in the water, and then he actually said, I baptize you in the name of the Father. She said her father, she thought her father would leave church over that. We do not believe. We do not believe in infant baptism. There are many, many denominations that believe in infant baptism. We do not. Early Methodist. And I will say this about any group. I call them holiness groups. Church of the Nazarene. I'm telling you, the Church of the Nazarene believes very little today. Church of the Nazarene, a holiness group. Methodist, they were a holiness group. We could throw in there probably the Assembly of God, holiness group. Church of God, holiness group. They believed in holiness. And before my mom was saved, she came over to my great-grandmother's house one time, and my mother was not dressed appropriately, and my great-grandmother just let her have it. She was a holiness group. They believe in losing your salvation. Holiness groups believe in losing your salvation. And a lot of these Methodist preachers that I've known, who believe in salvation by grace through faith, believe that you could lose your salvation. Baptists do not believe that. We simply do not believe that. We believe that a person who is saved is eternally saved, and we believe that we have scriptural evidence to back that up. And so when we talk about Baptist churches, I know that sometimes we get on that, and we say, well, the term Baptist did not exist. Look, if you say, I go to the First Baptist Church, the term Baptist for churches did not really come into existence until the 1600s. You say, well, what were they before that? Well, they were the church at Ephesus. They were the church at Smyrna. They were the church at Thessalonica. They were the church at Berea. That's what they were. Look, I would hope, and I mean this, this was said of Charles Spurgeon. Spurgeon said the worst thing that people said about him was his message was exactly the same message of the apostles 1900 years before him. And I would hope that we could say that our message is the message that the apostles preached 2,000 years ago. You say, well, preacher, are Baptist churches? And again, folks, like Heinz ketchup, that can't be right. How can there be 57 varieties of ketchup? But, you know, Heinz has 57 varieties of something. There are 57 varieties of Baptist churches. I'd like to think, maybe I'm wrong, I'd like to think that our church is pretty close. I'd like to hope so. I pray it so. That we are pretty close to what the church in the book of Acts was. That would be my desire for our church. Now, again, was the church of Jerusalem like the church of Antioch? No, absolutely not. They were different. Was the church at Berea like the church of Thessalonica? No, because this is what it says about Bereans. They search the scriptures daily to see whether those things were so or not. The Bible says they were more noble than those of Thessalonica. And so when we talk about that Patric was a Baptist, the truth is the term Baptist did not even exist at that time. It did not exist until it was in England, until about the mid-1600s, the term Baptist came in to being. You say, well, what were they? If you have never, and I can give you a copy of it, but if you have never read B.H. Carroll's Trail of Blood, it traces the Church of Jesus Christ in the book of Acts down through the centuries. Were they called Baptists in the Dark Ages? No. They were called the Waldenses. The Waldenses are pretty close to what we believe. They believed in reaching people. They were a terribly persecuted church by the church at Rome because they would not baptize infants. Because they believed that if a person was converted, they would rebaptize them. You say, well, weren't they baptized? No, baptized as a Catholic. But when they got saved, they were baptized. And so they were hounded by the Catholic Church. They were persecuted. Their children were slaughtered before their eyes. We are autonomous in that one of the things about Baptists is we believe in the separation of church and state. John Bunyan, not Paul's brother, but John Bunyan, the guy that wrote Pilgrim's Progress, would not take a license from the Church of England, and so he was thrown in jail for it. Patrick Henry, who was not a Baptist, but was a lawyer in Virginia, defended the Baptist against persecution because they would not take licenses in the state of Virginia. Even though they were beaten and imprisoned for it, they would not take license for it. And so like our forefathers, the Waldenses, the Albigenses, the Lollards, the Huguenots, I was pleased to read in my genealogy that my great-great-great-great-great-grandfather Duval that came over here was a French Huguenot, which was a French Baptist who was hounded out of France. You'll remember St. Bartholomew's Day Massacre, in which the Pope gave special indulgences to everybody who would kill a French Huguenot and throw them into the river. The term Baptist did not come into existence, but the church existed and has existed for the last 2,000 years. And so Psalm 37 says, fret not thyself because of evildoers. And we don't want to do that. We will continue. I want to speak to you how to have tranquility in a crazy world. How to have tranquility in a crazy world. But I guess that's for another night now, because you got me on St. Patrick, and so we just got off the subject tonight. But Patrick was not a Catholic. He was not that. It is obvious from his writings. He was, as we can say by what we believe, he was Baptistic in what he preached and what he believed. I would encourage you to go online, just look him up, and you can find the things that he actually said and the things that he actually believed. They're pretty much what you and I believe even to this day. Well, let's pray. Father, we thank you again. Now, Lord, for another evening. Lord, I pray that our church would be, Lord, I pray our church would be what you'd have to be. Lord, I know that they believed in the security of the believer. I know they baptized by immersion. I know that the churches were autonomous. I know they believed in soul liberty. Lord, we believe in that. Lord, I think of that verse in Luke where it says, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith? Lord, I pray that when you come, that you might find us to be faithful to the Word of God, that we might be true to it. Lord, I thank you for this evening. Thank you for the singing. Lord, thank you for everything that is said and done tonight. Lord, I thank you for our church. I thank you, Lord, for the folks who come here. I thank you, Lord, that we might grow in grace together. And I pray that we will grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I pray that this week you'll help us to identify with Jesus. I pray that people might know that, Lord, we take a stand for the Word of God, that the Word of God is true, that we believe the Bible is true. We believe the Bible was sent from God, the old as well as the new. Lord, that we believe, Lord, what you said. Lord, we believe that you shall come again. Lord, maybe tonight. Father, I pray again as we go. I ask that, Lord, you'll keep us safe this week. I pray, Lord Jesus, that you'll... Lord, I thank you for the folks who are here tonight. And Lord, most of us are out in the public every day. And Lord, we're around sick people every day. And Father, I pray that you'll keep us, Lord, well this week. Lord, again, there are so many in our church who have been afflicted, Lord, with this, some with the flu. Some have been afflicted with the flu. Some are with it tonight. They're sick, high fevers, temperatures, ache all over. Then, Lord, we think of those tonight with cancer. Lord, I want to pray for Cliff Bennett's wife tonight. I pray for Connie tonight. Lord, I know that the situation is serious. I know that it is. And Lord, I pray for her. Dear God, I know that you're in the healing business. Lord, I do not know what thy will is in her life, but Lord, I pray. Lord, as I pray for others, that Lord, you would heal her. I know that you can do that. But Lord, we have prayed for many people to be healed. Lord, I think of Richard Brooks, had his part of his lung taken out. I think of Becky Kogut's dad with cancer. I think of this lady that Lorraine Proffer, Lord, that Bonnie mentioned so often with brain cancer. I think of all the people that I read about online, people who are constantly posting, would you pray for my brother? Would you pray for my father? Would you pray for my mother? Would you pray for my sister? Would you pray for my cousin? They've got cancer, and it doesn't look good. Oh, God, I pray for all those that we know tonight with cancer. Lord, I pray, Lord, our prayer is that, Lord, you would comfort and meet the need of their heart, and, Lord, that you would help them. Father, again, we're so thankful for your love and your mercy to us. Lord, I pray that this week you'll give us a good week. Lord, I pray that you'll keep us safe. Lord, that you'll watch over us even as we travel, even home tonight. Lord, I pray that you bring us back again on Wednesday, Lord, as we again consider the life of that man after God's own heart, David. Oh, God, I pray that you'll help us as we study David. So much to learn. Lord, I pray and you'll help us, Lord. I think one of the greatest men in the Old Testament, despite all of his problems, despite all of his failures, David. So, Lord, bless, we pray now. Bring us back Wednesday night. I pray the weather would be such that we can be here, Lord. We've all heard the dire warnings of this is the end of the world this week. It's going to be a blizzard. It's like we've never seen blizzards before. But, Lord, I pray you'll make it so that we can be to church this week. And, Lord, I pray you'll watch over us, bless us, keep us safe. And, Lord, we'll thank and praise you for it now in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen and amen.